if you didn't know me before this morning, I think you kind of have a glimpse of who I am now. I've never put them in that sort of order. And when Sheila asked for me to do that, it was quite interesting. And then as I see it play out, he must have a lot of love for God and one another, which we're supposed to have. If you turn to 1 John chapter 3, we're going to be looking at verses 4 to verse 9. And we're going to talk about something called sin. If you were to ask a 6, 7, 8-year-old what sin was, they would respond by saying it's doing something against God. And that's true in its basic form. If you used to go to church, or if you go to church years back, they would have what they call fire and brimstone preachers. Anybody remember the fire and brimstone preachers? My goodness. One person that I remember hearing from, I was his pastor at my former church. He said, I just loved it when the preachers would get up there and their face would turn red. Well, there's a health concern with that. But they used to preach. As a matter of fact, Dwight L. Moody, a great evangelist, said one time that he likes to watch preachers who act like they are fighting flies all the way through the sermon. They used to preach fire and brimstone sermons. We have tamed down a lot as far as that goes, but the problem is we have also tamed down a lot sin, or we have winked at sin and said, well, that one isn't near as bad as what another one might be. I remember going to Lincoln Christian University, and the professor asked this question, do you know the difference between a big sin and a little sin? All of us knew better than to respond to that question, because we knew that he was going to answer his own question. He said, you know the difference between a big sin and a little sin is big sin is yours, the little sin is mine. That's how you know the difference between a big sin and a little sin. In late September 1864, Confederate General Nathan Bedford Forrest was leading his troops north from Decatur, Alabama, toward Nashville, Tennessee. But to make it to Nashville, Forrest would have to defeat the Union Army at Athens, Alabama. When the Union commander, Colonel Wallace Campbell, refused to surrender, Forrest asked for a personal meeting and took Campbell on an inspection of his troops. But each time, they left a detachment. The Confederate soldiers simply packed up and moved to another position, artillery and all. Forrest and Campbell would then arrive at the new encampment and continue to tally up the impressive number of Confederate soldiers and weaponry. By the time they returned to the fort, Campbell was convinced he couldn't win and surrendered unconditionally. Satan likes to deceive the Christian into thinking he must be a slave to sin. Once he has done that, the Christian surrenders unconditionally. We spoke about it this morning in our Sunday school class, the difference between negative thinking and positive thinking. Why is it every time that we talk, there is a complaint that comes out of our mouths, and I mean our mouths? Why is it that everything that we look at is negative? If you would ask if the water in the glass was half full or half empty, a lot of people would say, well, it's half empty. Why is it that we always go to the negative, or we always go to the complaint? I have appreciated what several said this morning as they walked in, because several of you have said, it's a beautiful morning. The sun is shining. It's such a beautiful morning. Where what we could have done, and a lot of people would have done, ooh, it's cold out there, isn't it? My goodness, it's freezing. I don't like this type of weather, but Some of you have chosen to look at the positive and not the negative and said, the sun is shining, it's going to be a good day. I remember working at Famous Bar when Famous Bar existed, Macy's took over it. I remember working at Famous Bar on the busiest day of the year. That was Black Friday. And we had cashed in, I was a cashier, and we had sent people through the line, and we just stayed at the cashier or at the cash register because we couldn't move, and we just kept on going. And the one that was behind me always said, good morning or good afternoon, how you doing, so glad you're here. And one of the people said, you have such a good attitude for being here hours on Black Friday. And he said, when I woke up this morning, I chose to have a good attitude. And it taught me a lesson that our attitude is a choice. We can decide whether we're going to have a good day or whether we're going to have a bad day. And the wonderful thing is that if we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, the circumstances shouldn't affect our life. Because we're having a good day every day because we have Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. But so many times we get wrapped up in the distractions of our life. We get wrapped up in the problems that is all around us, and we don't focus on the one priority of Jesus Christ. If you have found 1 John chapter 3, would you stand for the reading of God's word, please? Whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. And you know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him there is no sin. Whoever abides in him does not sin. Whoever sins has neither seen him nor known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin, because he has been born of God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you that we can come and we can hear your words, hear your message. And Lord, I pray in these verses that we'll get a better understanding of what John is saying here. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. First of all, what we have to do is we have to identify what sin is. And John is very clear here what sin is. Sin is lawlessness, or breaking the law, God's law specifically. Now, I'm not so much, because I'm getting older, and there's really two things that I'm allergic to. It's pain and cold. And when it gets cold, I get pain. Now, there's other things I'm allergic to. Somebody's going to sit here and go, oh, you're allergic to this. Pain and cold. And when it gets cold, I hurt. And there's probably several of you that are that way. So I'm not so much this way. But when I was younger, my favorite song was Born to Be Wild. And I lived that mantra. I was just born to be wild. I believed that rules were made to be broken. If there was a rule, it must be because they don't want me to have fun, or they don't want me to enjoy life. And so they set up this rule, that way I don't do it. And I'm not real good. Maybe this would be a good thing for Pastor Appreciation to know. I'm not real good if somebody looks at me and says, you have to do this. Because immediately my spirit says, oh, really? Watch me. Because I still have that spirit that says rules are made to be broken. But as I have become older and I have become wiser, I know in my mind and in my heart, that's not true. Because what I found out is rules are set up, boundaries are set up, guidelines are set up to protect me more than to kill my joy or my happiness or my fun. But for a long time, that was a battle with me. You want to set up a rule, I'm not going to abide by it. I'm not going to live by that rule. But there's safety in the law. People get mad and they will say that we are not under the law. They'll say, when Jesus came, we were no longer under the law that was set up in what we call the Mosaic law. However, the problem is they're wrong. The problem is that we can't live, we can't abide all of our life under that law. And the danger is this: once we break the law, we can't go back to not breaking the law. It's much like if I got out of Mulberry Grove and got onto Interstate 70 and started speeding, and then I look back some miles back and there's a cop in my rear view mirror with his lights going on. Now, my responsibility is to pull over, right? And so I pull over and the policeman says, "You've been speeding." And I know I've been speeding. But what I do is I look at him and I go, "If you don't mind, officer, I admit that I was breaking the law, but if you don't mind, can I go back to where I wasn't breaking the law? And then everything just be forgotten, and can I act like I didn't break the law?" Well, what's his response going to be? No, because once you've broken the law, you've broken the law, right? You can't go back to not breaking the law, and that's what it is with our lives. When we try to follow the law, once we break it, it's broken. You can't go back. So what did Jesus really do? It's not that Jesus came to abolish the law or to get rid of the law. He came to fulfill it. Let me show you the proof here. Matthew 5:17 says, "Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets," the Old Testament. "I did not come to destroy it, but I came to fulfill it." In other words, it is true that once I break the law, I cannot go back to not breaking the law. But what Jesus did was he came and he became my replacement for the cross. He took my punishment upon himself. Now, the only way he's able to do that is to be perfect and be without sin. And Scripture shares that also. But we are living lawless because there's not a one of us here, as Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Not a one of us here who has not broken that law. But Jesus took our penalty, death, upon himself. Sin appears to be good and appears to be entreating. I remember the fire in Brimstone where they talked about how awful sin was and how that it's no fun, and you won't want to do this, or you won't want to sin. Well, that's not true. If you remember part of my testimony, when I came forward to get saved, the pastor asked me on the first night, "Do I want to get rid of all my sin?" And I answered honestly, "No." You know, there's some sin that I still enjoy. There's some sin I still like. I want to continue to do that. But these that I've run into the dead end with, those I want to get rid of. Is that all right? And the pastor said, "No, that's not all right. Because when we come to Jesus, we must surrender all of our sins to him, not hang on to some of them." So I wasn't ready to be saved on that first night. But sin appears to be really, really good and really, really entreating and something that I want. And we tell our minds, we say, "That's really going to be beneficial to me." Can I take a moment and share with you what I mean? There are many people who play the lottery because what they want to do, what their desire is to do, is to become rich quick. And so they win the lottery, whatever millions there is, they win the lottery, and they receive that money, And something happens between that time. It's really, really good. And they may have had great ambition for the reason why they want the money. But within a year, they're broke. They have no money. What happened? They had all these grandeur ideas of buying a house, buying a mansion, buying a fancy car, buying all that they could ever possibly dream they would ever want. Because the lie is, my money will never run out. And yet, it does. Johnny Paycheck, you may know several of you may know that name. I've been to his tombstone. He couldn't afford his own tombstone. He was a very rich man, per se. He was the one who wrote this and made popular the song, Take This Job and Shove It. But he was very popular. He had a sidekick, if you will. He had a partner who helped him out. His name was George Jones. What happened when Johnny Paycheck passed away? He died penniless. He didn't have a dime to his name. And George Jones set up in his lot a place for Johnny Paycheck. We'd look at people that we would think have arrived, have made it, they became famous. But you can visit almost on a daily basis the police beat, and their name is in it for some particular reason. Of course, their police beat seems to be entertainment nightly, but they're in it, and not for good reasons. These people we set up and go, wow, if I could just be them just for a moment. Baseball players get millions and millions of dollars, and yet they don't seem to find fulfillment and satisfaction in the money that they make. So isn't there something else there? It is a lie to love money. There's something more. The law allows us to know the guidelines and the boundaries, but we cannot escape sin. We are not good enough to avoid sin. Even when we're saved, we can't avoid sin. Now, it's interesting. In the scripture that I read, says, those who are saved don't sin. Now, hold on to that for a moment, because I'm going to explain that to you. But even in the dreams, even in the alcoholics, there's not a single person who has gotten up when they were 6 and 7 years old, and as many adults do, ask them what they want to do when they become older. Not a one of them has ever said, I desire to be an alcoholic. Alcoholism, narcotics, drugs, and many other things is a promise to relieve the pain that you are feeling. Now, I get upset whenever I hear somebody say, well, you know, they're addicted to drugs or they're addicted to alcohol, and as though they're bad people. I don't have proof of this, but I fully believe it. 99.9% of the people that are living on this earth are addicted to something. So they're not worse than what we are. We're all in the same boat. We're addicted to something. And why are we addicted to it? Because for a moment we get a release that says, I can alleviate all your pain right now if you give in to this addiction. Sometimes my addiction can be my video games. And when I sit there and I play my video games, I escape me for a little while. My pain for a little while. Here's the problem. At the end of that, if I don't control that, at the end of that, I will go, I wasted a whole day sitting here playing a video game. And what is my reward for it? Nothing but regret. Nobody aspires to be a slave to that thing. Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." There is a better way. Sin is a prison. Remember the Eagle Song Hotel, California? Now, I've just brought up country music. Now I'm bringing up rock and roll. Yes, that's me. Remember the song Hotel California? I have actually listened to the lyrics of that. If you pay attention, next time you hear it, pay attention to it. What is it talking about? It's talking about a drug addiction. And listen to what the words are about Hotel California. You can check out, but you can never leave. What that means is sin is a prison. You can never leave. It is a picture of hopelessness. Yet we have all sinned, Romans 3:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." I really didn't know that verse. We all have sinned, but we don't have to live a life of sin, and that's what John is speaking of here. He's not saying that we won't slip up every once in a while and sin. What he's saying is, as we abide, as we live with Christ, as we walk with him, we don't have to live a life of sin. We don't have to be the slave to sin if we are a slave to righteousness. There's not a one of us who is perfect except for Jesus. We were living in a life of sin. We gave our life, we surrendered our life to that sin, but there is a better way. And how is that better way? John points that out as well. He says, Jesus manifested himself. In other words, he came to this earth. He was born. We will celebrate that over the next 4 months, called Christmas, that Jesus came to this earth. But he didn't come to this earth to live. He came to this earth to die on a cross and raise the third day. We are hopeless without Jesus doing this. Jesus went to the cross to save us, to rescue us from our sin. He rose again to show us that we can have victory in him. There's some in the church, and I apologize on their behalf, who look for perfection. You have to be perfect. And they'll grab a hold of verses like this and say, see, we don't have to sin anymore. Well, as long as we are breathing in this body, there will be that temptation to sin. It's not perfection, it is progression. Am I better? Am I doing better today than I was last week or yesterday or last month? And how can we progress? We can't progress without Jesus Christ. We come to Jesus just as we are. We're broken, we're sinners, we're hopeless, yet Jesus comes to us as we are, but he will not leave us there. It would be terrible if a new parent got a brand new baby and didn't expect that baby to grow up, but kept it as a baby 20, 30, 40 years, never teaching it anything, never sending it to school, never doing anything other than keeping it being a baby. We would look at that and go, that's pathetic, that's sad, and that's wrong. Yet what we do is we don't expect people to progress in their Christian faith. We expect them to be like, well, coaches to referees. Perfect. I am a referee, and I'm an umpire, and guess what? I'll be the first to admit I make mistakes. I may not see something. I may miss a play or two. I may space out for a moment. You do that when you're umpiring bases. And you miss it. But every time I get on the court or every time that I get on the baseball field, I need to be better than I was the last time I got on the baseball field or got on the court. There needs to be a progression. In our Christian faith, there needs to be a progression. It reminds me of the man who lived a life that was terrible. He was a fighter. He would go to bars a lot, and he would get into fights and be arrested and carted off to jail. Well, he gave his life to Jesus. He got saved, and he came to church, and he was quite regular, and for many months he was quite regular. And then one day he got into a fight with someone who also attended church, so much that he went to his vehicle and he got a baseball bat and he bashed the person he was arguing with, he bashed his car in. I mean, it was a wreck. And so the man put his baseball bat back in his vehicle. He drove off and he didn't come to church for a month. And the pastor and the deacons were getting concerned about that. And so they went and they visited him. And he explained to them, "I can't come back to your church." He said, "Did you not see what I did to that guy's vehicle? Did you not see that I bashed it in and it's a total wreck? And did you not see that?" And the pastor, with the wisdom of God, said, "Yes, but let me ask you a question. What would have you done if you wasn't saved?" He said that car, instead of the car, would have been that guy's face. And the pastor looked at him and said, "See, God is working in your life. It wasn't his face. It was his car. But God is working in your life." The shame of it is that there are people who will hear that story and judge him because he bashed in the car and not see the progression of him not bashing in the guy's face. It's not perfection, it's progression. And it's by the work of the Holy Spirit. When we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit comes in to our lives and fills us up. And how do we know that the Holy Spirit is there? Because whenever we have a desire, a temptation to live in sin, to give in to that sin, we have the Holy Spirit who taps us on the shoulder and says, "That is dangerous. Yeah, that is sin. You don't want to do that." Now, we can quiet that spirit, the Holy Spirit, and say, "I'm going to do what I want to do, when I want to do it, how I want to do it." Or we can give in and surrender to God's will. And let me share this with you. When we give in to that sin, we live with regrets that we wish we had never done that. When we give in to the Holy Spirit, God works it out in a way that we cannot even dream. There's a pastor who was having problems with his deacons. His name was not Doug. I have wonderful deacons. There's a pastor who was having problems with his deacons. And every time that they met, there was something negative they wanted to give to him about himself. Well, he wanted to say something, and this preacher is big. He wanted to say something. He wanted to just lash out at him. And he said, "No, wait a minute, I'll blow it. I think what I'll do instead is I think I'll pray." And so he started praying, and he prayed individually for them. And he said it was interesting because one by one by one, they all came and they apologized to the pastor for the way they had treated him over the last 6 months. The pastor stepped back and he thought, "You know what? If I would have done it my way, I would have blown it. Probably would have been fired. And I most certainly couldn't live with myself. When I gave it to God, God did a better job than what I could ever even dream." The Holy Spirit works in our lives if we know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. But the choice is ours. Romans 10:9, I know you know it well because I say it almost every Sunday. that if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart he's raised from the dead, we will be saved. That means that the choice is on us, because Jesus doesn't force himself on anybody. So he's asking, what will you do with the message that is given today? Is Jesus really our Lord? Is he our boss? Is what he says go, or do we still hold on to what we want? Is it our decisions that we live by, or is it Jesus's? John 10:10 says this, "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly." Satan's sole goal to those who know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior is he is out to get you. He wants to steal, he wants to kill, he wants to destroy. But here's the good news. Jesus is far greater than what Satan could ever be, and he lost at the cross. So we need to follow the one who truly holds the victory. Are we hopeless? Jesus is our victory. Jesus was manifested. He lived, he died, he rose again. He is our victory. He was the only one who can pay the price that needed to be paid. There are some people who believe that we ought to do away with Easter. Good Friday is wonderful. We'll talk about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ and how great that is. But they don't see a need for Jesus' resurrection. I don't want you to be uninformed. I want to share with you the reason why we celebrate the resurrection. If Jesus would have simply died, laid in the tomb, and never rose again, he would not be God. He would not be the Son of God. For there are many great men who have died, who they have called God, but they are still in the tomb. Jesus rose the third day. Why? So that we could have victory in our own lives. And the hope, the greatness, is that when we do die physically, we will raise again, and Jesus is the first fruits, the example of that. Aren't you glad that this isn't it? I mean, some people have been ugly all their life. And when they get to heaven, they're going to be beautiful. Some people have been sick all their life. I say this. I've never known, honestly, I've never known what it has ever been to be well, to not have some physical sickness. When I was born, I had the baby diseases, mumps, measles, those type of things. When I was in grade school, every month I had to go to the doctor and get hemoglobin because my insulin, or not my insulin, but my immune system is very, very low. When I was 25, I got diabetes, and I'm still diabetic. I've never known what it is to be well. But the glorious thing is, one of these days, this body is going to give out, this body is going to die, and I'm going to go to heaven, and finally, I'll get to know what it means to be well. And I'll be weller, that's a word, weller than I've ever been before in my life. That's victory. Reminds me of Fanny Crosby, who was blind at such an early age. A preacher, because we're not known to really know how to keep our mouth shut, but a preacher came to her and said, "How terrible it is that you've been blind all your life." And she stopped him immediately and said, "Don't say that." She said, "'Cause can you imagine the first face that I'm going to see is when I get to heaven, I will see the face of my Jesus. The first face I'll see." We have victory in Jesus. And the greatest victory is this, that because he has paid the price for those who are lawless, for those who are sinful, we can claim the blood of Jesus and we can be clean forever. as though we have never sinned before in our life. That's called justification. Because when God the Father looks at us, he sees Jesus. And when he sees Jesus, he sees us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you that we have heard your message. And Lord, there may be here some who find themselves falling again and again and again into the same sin, into the same lawlessness that they've known throughout their life. And they would really like to know, honestly, is there true victory in you? And Lord, I pray that you reveal that to them. Lord, there may be some here who don't know you as Lord and Savior. They don't know that victory that you can give them. Lord, there may be some here who has been saved for years, but still not living in that victory. And I pray, Lord, that we turn our eyes upon you. In Jesus' name, amen. Are you following him, or are you trying to continue to live the way that you're living? Has sin gotten you down and you have found no hope? Jesus is your hope. Upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Thank you for coming. Don't forget that